Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Avairy Attorney. If you remember in the last episode, we didn't manage to save Mademoiselle Zian. We did manage to get the Spanish prince, well, he claimed he was a Spanish prince, but obviously he was Renard, the private investigator. But we managed to get him off the hook, but unfortunately Mademoiselle Sienne, who was of course the actual person who tried to assassinate the king, albeit under she was threatened, I guess, into doing it, so that's unfortunate. But today is a new day. It is January the 25th, Tuesday. And we have to meet Inspector Voltaire, I think it is, at the Place de la Bastille. A rooftop cafe overlooking the Bastille Square is the perfect spot for a friendly rendezvous. Let's go, I guess. Brrr. It's far too cold to be meeting on a rooftop cafe. Why couldn't the inspector have chosen a comfier location? Who knows? Maybe the inspector liked the view because it reminds him of his days guarding the old Bastille under the Ancien Regime. Wait, you think the inspector worked here during the Ancien Regime? Think so? He got his war wounds? It was a joke, Sparrison. I'm pretty sure the inspector isn't that old. Well. Severin, what are you doing here? Settle down, JJ. Just like you, I was invited here by the inspector. What could he want with all three of us? It's hardly unusual for the lawyers and the police of France to collaborate. The inspector probably has a big investigation role that requires all hands on deck. A big investigative role? Sounds juicy. Oh, by the way, did you hear what happened to Judge Romulus? No, what? Turns out that he acquired his position as judge through illegal means, so a warrant has been put out for his arrest. He's a wanted... He acquired his position through illegal means? What does that even mean? I'm a little hazy on the details. Something about pushing another judge into the Seine. I can believe that. Yes, if you remember, he pushed us into the old Falcon here, into the Seine. Anyway, I'm sure he'll be caught before long. Nobody managed to escape the long arm of the law forever. Speaking of which... I can't remember the voice I did for this guy. Ah, good. You're all here. Excuse me, Monsieur, Mr. Inspector Volerti, sir. Falcon and I were wondering, did you get your injuries while defending the old Bastille prison? Don't drag me into this, you fool. I was joking. You impotent whelps. I'm not that old. I sustained these injuries when in the July Revolution 18 years ago. I was a royal guard, just a lowly peon. The air was thick with gunpowder and blood. Oh, great, now you've set him off. We were given the order to charge the rebel barricade. My comrades and I fastened our bayonets. Suddenly, boom, without warning, a gunpowder keg exploded. My comrades were dead. I was heavily wounded. That's when I looked up and saw a looming figure standing between the gargoyles and Notre Dame. It was the Viridian Killer himself. Ahem. This is a fascinating story, Inspector, but perhaps you could tell us why we're here. Oh, right, of course. Why we're here. What I'm about to tell you is to remain strictly confidential. You understand, it's a matter of national security. As you probably heard, France is under threat from a certain heinous group. Hipsters? It's true. The other day I was called a pop loving pleb for enjoying Chopin. Now's not the time for joking, you two. The inspector's obviously talking about the growing rumours of an uprising. Correct, a rebellion is coming. Indeed, rebels. There's a storm brewing in the shadows of Paris. We, the Paris Police Department, have known about it for months. No, years. In every tavern and on every street corner, people talk of organising protests and overthrowing the government. king has ordered for public gatherings to be dispersed and newspapers to be censored. But the whispers of dissent remain. No surprise there. If you take away an angry citizen's ability to speak, they will just get even angrier. Indeed. And that's why it's paramount that we find a strike at the heart of the rebellion group as soon as possible. For that, I need your help. What exactly do you want us to do? Interview citizens, scout locations, find the secret rebel meeting location, let us escape the eyes of the police. Do we have any needs? Just one. We know the rebels are having weapons supplied to them by a crooked merchant, who is only referred to as the Croque-Monsieur. Like the sandwich? It's a cheese and ham sandwich. What? The Croque-Monsieur. It's a hot sandwich. Cheese, ham, a little bechamel. Throw on some peppers if it's a Friday night. This has nothing to do with sandwiches. Croque-Monsieur is the alias of an accomplished and notoriously dangerous arms dealer. In any case, that's everything the Parisian police know. That's everything? That's all you have to demonstrate after years of tracking? Naturally, as a public prosecutor, it is my duty to help the police with their investigative work. It would be an honour to lead any and all assistance. Sock up. That's very good to hear, Monsieur Cocorico. But what about you, Falcon? Well, to be honest, Inspector, I don't quite understand why you're asking me. I'm a private defence attorney. I work for citizens who get stuck in legal trouble. Rebel hunting isn't quite my forte. You want to know why I'm asking you? Look around you, Falcon. We're surrounded by corruption and incompetence. The judges are bloodthirsty wolves, the jailers are thieving ravens, and the National Guard are sitting ducks. Look at the slackers and dullards who supposedly protect and serve this country. Nobody cares about justice anymore. You saw my shameless display at the previous trials. These are the results I produced with imbeciles to assist me. But you three, you care. Falcon, I saw you defending Dame Catalina Prince Juan. I heard of your escapades around the city, frantically collecting evidence and interviewing witnesses. Frankly, you did more investigative work over the last month than I've seen any policeman do in a year. Not including myself, of course. But Dame Catalina, it doesn't matter. You have passion and conviction. You aren't a total bird brain. By my book, that makes you a fantastic investigator, even if that is not in your job description. So what do you say? Do you want to sit around your office, twiddling your thumbs, till another pointless job offer falls into your lap? Or do you want to take this opportunity to do something great and help us track down the animals who wish to harm our glorious nation? Fine. It would be an honour to help my country, Inspector. Consider us on board. Excellent, just what I wanted to hear. I had no idea you're such a patriot, Junior. There's nothing wrong with a little national pride. Pride is final, but do we get any compensation for this? Of course, here's 50 francs. You'll receive another 50 upon completion of your work. 50 francs? Psh, we've been undersold. Hush, Sparrow son. This is a great opportunity. I don't want to keep you any longer than necessary. You already have all the key facts of the investigation. Find the elusive Croque-Monsieur, find where the rebels are congregating. These are your two tasks. I will check on your progress in 3 weeks' time, see what you can accomplish by then. I'll be doing my own independent investigation into the rebel group, J&J, so I suppose this is a competition of sorts. Try to keep up with me. Don't make me laugh, Severin. I'll have all the rebel leaders behind bars before you even have your first suspect. Come on, Sparrowson, we have a Croque-Monsieur to hunt. Okay, let's go. Yeah, I knew a little competition would kick those bird brains into gear. Well, Inspector, this has been a productive meeting. I should probably start my investigation into Croque-Monsieur too. Not so fast, Concorico. There is something else we need to discuss. Interesting. I wonder what they're going to discuss. Ooh, hello, look at all the bases we can go to, my goodness. Okay, so that would probably be a good place to start. Library. Chocolate Emporium. Ah, we could ask these guys as well. hospital. I think we're going to go and ask R&M. And there's Renard himself. Well, well, this is most unexpected. Monsieur Falcon, Monsieur Sparrison, I believe this is the first time meeting without our disguises or pretenses, as it were. Oh, but first things first. Mousy, would you kindly fetch our guest some tea?
Of course, Mr. Valpez, of course.
Messieurs, what sort of tea would you like? Camembert, Darjeeling, maybe? I actually like chamomile. Chamomile sounds good to me. Thanks, Mousy. Sure, I could go for chamomile too.
Okay, one bottle of chamomile coming right up.
Let's get down to business. What is it you two came here for? We just have a couple of questions. Have you heard of the Croque-Monsieur? Have you ever heard of a person called the Croque-Monsieur? And no, we aren't talking about the sandwich, unfortunately. The Croque-Monsieur? Are you referring to the black market salesman, the man who claims to be able to procure anything, no matter how illegal?
Yes, that sounds exactly like the person we were looking for. Do you know him?
Me personally? No, monsieur. I just know of his vile reputation.
I see. And do you have any idea how we can find him?
Meeting the Croque-Monsieur face to face is not easy. The man doesn't make himself known to just anybody, after all.
I know. I shall do a little investigative work of my own.
Come back in 3 days and I will tell you where and when you can find that Croque-Monsieur.
That's an enormous help. Thank you so much, Monsieur Valpez.
Of course, there is a price.
A price?
It's just a small fee, a mere 30 francs.
Hey, we saved your derriere over the Prince Juan business. Is there any way to show your gratitude?
Monsieur Valpez, you must understand this is no personal errand. We're investigating on behalf of king and country. I'm sure your intentions are noble, Monsieur Falcon, but I'm running a business here. A fox has to eat.
30 francs, and I guarantee you will find a Croque-Monsieur. That's my final offer. What do you say?
Yeah, we'll take it.
Here you go, monsieur. Very good.
As I promised, returning 3 days later, and I will tell you where the Croque-Monsieur can be found.
Rest assured that I will undertake my end of the bargain with care and diligence.
I expect nothing less. Thank you, Monsieur Valpez.
It is my pleasure. Was there anything else you wanted to ask?
Monsieur Valpez, have you heard any rumours of an uprising?
Of course, these days a man can't walk into a tavern without hearing angry men whispering about violence and revolt.
I dare say the prince may find himself in the midst of yet another revolution before the end of winter.
But what can you tell us about the dissenters specifically? Do you know where they are meeting?
I'm afraid I only know what you can read in the papers, monsieur.
I know anti-government protesters were meeting out in the open until the government clamped down on large public banquets.
With the banquets gone, who knows where the dissenters went?
I see.
Perhaps I can assist you with something else.
I think that's it.
That's all. Have a pleasant day, Monsieur Valpez.
As do you, messieurs.
What about the tea? Her tea's ready.
Her tea's ready, Monsieur Valpez. It's ready.
I'm afraid you're too slow, Mercy.
Oh, bother.
We'll see. Okay, so that's one day. One day gone. So we don't want to go there. Don't want to go there. I say we go to the canard oil.
No. No drinking. Bad Falcon.
Calm down, Sparrison. I'm just here for some information. Tavern's the first place people go to moan about the government. Therefore, they are perfect rebel breeding grounds.
Oh, that makes sense.
Ah, it's you too. What will it be today? Wine or beer?
I'm afraid it's just questions for now, Madame Quesnel.
We're looking for a man called the Croque-Monsieur. Have you seen him?
No, that name doesn't sound familiar at all.
Okay. Have you heard of any of your patrons badmouthing the government?
Of course, this is a tavern, hun.
People can't come here to grope and talk politics. Where else could they go? That's true. But has anyone stood out? Well, just between you and me, the pair on the drinking floor have been acting very shifty. Now, I'm not saying they are or aren't rebels, but they're doing far too much talking and not enough drinking, if you know what I mean. I think I do. Thank you, madame. Let's see where to go. Drinking floor. I'm not going to the card room. I'm not losing more money. And that's when the mademoiselle told me to put the order in. No idea where she's going to keep him, though. Pierre, you know that she hates being called mademoiselle. You're going to get stuck with guard duty again. All right, you are. It's madame it is then. Wait, she ain't married, is she? So why do we have to call her madame? Why don't you ask her yourself? No way. She'd straight up eat me alive if I asked her directly. Wait, hush up. Do you smell that? Smells like... eavesdroppers. Can I help you, messieurs? What are you talking about? What are you two just talking about before we rudely interrupted? Well, I would like to include you in our conversation, but to be perfectly honest, I don't think that's any of your business. It is our business. We want to join the rebels. As a matter of fact, it is our business. You see, we want to fight alongside the rebels. We do? Listen here, you. Hold on, Piero. Let me handle this. Listen, messieurs. I've seen you two around a couple of times. We're acquaintances, I suppose. Now, I don't know who you are, but I do know that your line of work involves a fair amount of investigation. Now, I must assume that you're some sort of detective or prosecutor. Am I far off the mark? Well, as I thought, I don't claim to be part of any secret rebel alliance. I never heard of such a thing, but if I were a member of any such hypothetical group, I would not allow the entry of a man of the law like yourself, understood? Damn, that's a solid shutdown. Yeah, I'll try asking something else. Monsieur, have you heard of a man called... Falcon, wait. There's a slight chance these guys might be rebels, right? So if we ask directly, they might be scared off. Good point. I'll try to keep it subtle. The Croque-Monsieur, tell me everything. Where did you get that rifle? Monsieur, I see you carry a rifle. Evidently. Who manufactured it? Ah, good question. See, most hunters around here are carrying old French Charleville's, but this beauty is something special. See, it's an American from the Springfield Armory, model 1812, percussion lock firing mechanism. An American musket, you say? That's certainly quite special. It must have been hard to procure. It's true that you can't buy guns of this quality from standard street sellers, but you know the right people. Please go on. Well, okay, listen carefully. You didn't hear it from me, but to meet the Croque-Monsieur. Actually, it'd be foolish of me to explain in public. It'd be much easier if you just take this. The Book of Judges? Was it some sort of law book? The book's subject is not important. Just take it. Oh, I see. It's THE Book of Judges from the Bible. Old Testament stories of God smiting people and stuff. I appreciate the gift, monsieur, but I am not religious. Nor am I. Then why are you... Just take it, you idiot. Bible books are what we use to pass around in code phrases, don't we? Code phrases? Piero, please, I'm trying to be low-key. I couldn't do that if you're mouthing off with that big beak of yours. Right you are. Try to forget what my friend said. Just with a little searching and with the contents of that good book, you should be able to get what you desire. Is that a religious metaphor? No, monsieur. I'm being very literal. Book of Judges has been handed to your evidence folder. Well, thank you very much for the gift, monsieur. But to be honest, I have no idea how this is supposed to lead me to our gun salesman. Ah, I see. Well, hey, there's an excellent friar who performs Bible readings in Notre Dame Cathedral. Perhaps if you show the man the new book, he'll be able to find you a particularly spiritual passage. Are you sure this is not a religious metaphor? I feel like you're trying to convert me. I assure you, I'm as secular as they come, Monsieur. Fire at Notre Dame Cathedral. Thank you, Monsieur. I'll make a note. Was there something else you wanted? That's all. Thank you for your assistance, messieurs. It's nothing. Get out of here already. You two seem like decent fellows. You shouldn't get involved in this rebellion business. Just do whatever you need to do with the Croque-Monsieur and get out of Paris. That's what smart people would do. I appreciate the advice, Monsieur. I think we can get out of it and go to the cathedral. Are we ready to hit the road? Yes. Let's make a move. Okay. We want to go to Notre Dame. There's lots of places to go to. What's this? Oh. That's a mystery, though. Let's go to Notre Dame. Falcon Sparrow's son step into the grand atrium of Notre Dame Cathedral. Scaffolding lines much of the crumbling outer wall. Unperturbed, a handful of devotees are silently kneeled in thought. Here for a little prayer, are we, Falcon? I had no idea you were the religious type. Don't be silly. I'm following up on Fontaine's lead. We must find our mystery friar. Do you think it's that hunched over fella over there? I bet it's him. He looks super suspicious. Could be. Let's show some tact. Excuse me, Monsieur Friar. Do you know what tact is, Sparrowson? Friar, miss. Welcome, my brothers. Welcome. All are welcome under the roof of the house of God. Are you here to confess your sins, or perhaps you wish to join in our services? Actually, Friar, we're here because... Falcon, that friar, he looks eerily familiar. It's the judge. Now that you mention it, he does look a little like the guy who delivers our post, doesn't he? What? No, no, that's not what I meant. How does he look anything like our postman? Am I going mad? Your friend appears to be upset. Don't mind him. He's just in a huff because he thinks you look like the judge we once met. Judge Romulus? I get that all the time. I'm his twin brother, you see. Oh, good. I'm not going mad. Friar, would you say that he had a good relationship with Romulus? We were close, but as you may have heard, he got into trouble with the law recently. I haven't seen him in weeks. I see. I didn't mean to pry. It's no trouble. But tell me, why are you here, brothers? Oh, right. Well, we have a couple of questions. Could you take a look at this? Friar, we have something we'd like to show you. Could you take a look at this? We heard you give special passage readings. Oh, I see. You have your own copy of the Book of Judges. I think you'll find chapter 15, verse 2 to be particularly enlightening. Let's see. Chapter 15, verse 11. This chapter follows the journey of Samson, the heroic judge with divine strength. In this part of the scripture, Samson is confronted by the men who are angered by Samson's notion of justice. Please, could you read the passage? Okay. 3,000 men of Judah went to the top of the rock Etam. They said to Samson, "Knowest thou not the Philistines are rulers over us? What is this that hast done unto us?" And Samson said unto them, "As they did unto me, so have I done unto them. As they did unto me, so I have done unto them." A beautiful sentence, wouldn't you agree? Sure, it's poetic. A beautiful summation of justice. You understand the passage? It's delightful to hear. Yes, Samson was a great judge. Not a judge of today who sits on a high chair and files endless paperwork, but an old judge, a holy judge, a shofet. Shofets were to be admired and feared. They made their own judgments and dispensed their own punishments. Oh, I'm starting to ramble, aren't I? Okay, let's get back to the point. The key word of the day is Etam. That's the name of the cave where Samson hid the rock of Etam. Etam, got it. I'll make a note. It's like a backward mate. But I'm confused. What do you do with the keyword? This is for you to learn on your own, my brothers. You appear to be intelligent. I'm sure that if you put your faith in the right people, you can uncover the truth. We'll see what we can do. Is there anything else I can help you with today? Perhaps you wish to make a confession? What's with all the scaffolding? Is some sort of construction work going on? That's right, a little repair, a little renovation. It's no secret that a cathedral has seen better days. The cult of reason did a lot of damage back in the days of the revolution. But now we're well on our way to restoring this holy place to its former glory. The cult of reason? The religion of Christianity? Hey Falcon, what's the difference between a religion and a cult? Don't be rude, Sparrowson. Don't worry, my brother. I understand how it is. To a young person, all ideologies look like gobbledygook in different packaging, don't they? Pretty much. Maybe you'll come to learn the difference as you grow up. I promise some ideologies are worth following to the very end. But let's not talk any more about cults and ideologists. Did you want anything else? That's all. I think we're done here. Thank you for your time, Friar. Go in peace, my brothers. Okay. So is that... We don't have the place to go to yet. We started on the 25th, so we go back to R&M. Monsieur Volpez, you've managed to dig up some good information, I trust. There is good news and there is bad news. Let's hear the good news. I found a way you can meet the Croque-Monsieur. He looks around the Rue de Marmoset's on Friday evenings. The Rue de Marmoset's? Oh, the Monkey Road by Notre Dame. That seems simple enough, so what's the bad news? The Croque-Monsieur refused to speak to anyone who does not know a secret password. And I'm afraid I was unable to procure that particular password. I see, that is a problem. I apologize that I could not be of more help. It's not a problem at all, Monsieur. You've given us a fantastic lead. Rue de Marmoset's on Friday? I'll be there. I think we know what the password is. We do? Come on, Falcon, don't be a bird brain. I shan't delay you any longer. I'm sure you have a lot of investigative work to do. That we do. Thanks for all the help, Monsieur Volpez. Okay. Rue de Marmosets. No sign of the Croque-Monsieur. Say, what was it that Renard told us? He said the man lurks around Rue de Marmosets on Fridays. Falcon, today is not Friday. Oh, yeah. Oh, it isn't, is it? Have we got to wait all the way till Friday? If it's Sunday? Okay. Do we want to go? Do you know where I want to go? I want to go back to that bloody chocolate emporium and... Welcome, welcome, it's you two again. You remember us? I guess that's no surprise. Of course I remember. You are the messieurs who ask many questions and buy little chocolate. I'm afraid we have more questions today, Monsieur Hagel Slack. Thanks for being patient with us. You sell chocolate to a lot of people. Have you come across any unsavory characters in your occupation? Of course, fun time. I was hiking through the mountains of the Netherlands and I was accosted by an overzealous tulip salesman. I threw a fistful of Dutch rubles at him and made a hasty retreat. A can't help but wonder about the legitimacy of Lander's stories. But for some reason, his tangential rants don't bother me. Let's be more severe. We're looking for a person called the Croque-Monsieur. Does that name sound familiar? No, monsieur. Have you heard any rumours of rebellion in Paris recently? Fine, monsieur. There are always rumours of rebellion in Paris. The citizens whisper in the shadows, the bourgeois cower in fear. Yes, yes, but have you personally heard of anything specific? No, monsieur. That's all. I suppose we're done here. Gets me to look for an intel about rebellion in a chocolate shop. Yeah, well, okay. Perhaps I could help with something else, monsieur. Like what? For you may notice that this is in fact a chocolate shop. I am of much better service as a chocolate salesman than a rumour monger. Ah, of course. We could buy a box of chocolates for a friend. May I have a recommendation? Could it be? Am I the friend, Falcon? Is this a gift for me? Certainly, monsieur. If you're looking for something romantic, then perhaps an elegant heart-shaped selection from Tuscany would suit you. Romantic, you say? I don't feel that way about you, Falcon. How can I such a scrumptious gift? No, that wouldn't work. Do you have anything else that would be suitable for any occasion? Ah, then perhaps you want this box of 20 creamy chocolate swirls from London. They are very sweet. Nobody can resist. Yes, those are perfect. Take the Falcon. Take them. For pity's sake, Sansa, why are you being so fidgety? No reason. Then cut it out. It's weird. I think those would work nicely, Monsieur Hagelsack. How much are they? 5 francs. Perhaps a little steep for some, but I assure you that their quality more than justifies the price tag. I'll take them. May I have them wrapped? Certainly, monsieur. One moment, if you please. For Falcon, what is it? I just want to say you've been a great friend and an inspirational mentor. I've ample amounts of respect for you as a person, and... You do know these chocolates aren't for you, right? Oh. Yeah, I knew that. Good, just making sure. You're breaking my heart, Falcon. Here you are, monsieur. I'm sure the recipient will enjoy them. But it has been added to your evidence folder. Thank you very much, monsieur. And thank you for putting up with our endless questions. Ha. Huh. It has been my pleasure, monsieur. That was hilarious. God, I love Sparrison. Okay. So it's Monday. Where do we want to go? Let's go to the ballet. Excuse me, madam, do you have a moment to talk about the cult of reason? Peddle your pyramid screens to someone else, bud. I've got a kid to feed. Madame, it's not a pyramid scheme. Madame, take a leaf at least. What about you, monsieur? Would you like to learn about the glorious teaching of Jacques Herbert? Yeah, a cult is it? Not today, monsieur. I've already been in my fair share of cults. But this cult is different. A member of the cult of reason, huh? Strange. I thought that cult died out back in the old revolution. Hey, Falcon, that person. He looks like a run-of-the-mill cultist. I can see that, but doesn't his face look familiar to you? He does look familiar. Actually, the resemblance is uncanny. Shall we get him attention? Uh-oh, he spotted us. Wait, monsieur. We would like a quick word. Come back. Teach us about the wonders of the cult of reason. He's gone. So I'm not going crazy, right? That guy was a spinning image of Judge Romulus, wasn't he? I can't deny the similarity. Then again, there are plenty of wolves in Paris. Maybe there's no link at all. Either way, we have an investigation to conduct. Let's focus on that. Right, where to first? Let's go to the garden first. Hey, Falcon, is that our old friend? You promised to get my sentence reduced. What happened with that? Why am I still stuck doing mule work, huh? Oh yeah, I forgot about that. Well, we've been a little distracted. We had this messy case. And now we're investigating stuff. But I guess we can fit in some time to see the judge. Oh mon dieu, forget it. I've only got another week to go and then I'm done with this dumb job. So what do you want? I haven't found any interesting bits of paper today, if that's what you were hoping for. We actually just wanted to ask a couple of questions if you have a moment. I have a moment. Just the one, mind. Yeah, what's the deal? What, did you see that cultist in the Palais de Carousel? Yep. He's been hanging around all week. Today he tried to hand me a leaflet, so I told him where to put it. And where would that be? What? Where did you tell him to put the leaflet? Oh. I see, never mind. Monsieur Rubinia, what do you know about that guy? What's his story? His story? How should I know? He's just a cultist loser. The Louvre attracts these types of crazies all the time. I see. Do you want something else? That's all. We'll let you get back to your work, monsieur. Let's see. Who to question? Oh dear, it's those guys again. Keep it together, Eric. Maybe they won't recognize you. Excuse me, monsieur, it's us. The Philistines, remember? Were they talking to me? Yeah, but definitely talking to me. Okay, deep breaths, Eric. Hi. We have a couple of questions, if not no trouble. Oh, it's no trouble. No trouble at all. Did you see that cultist outside? The cultist? You mean the cult of reason, fellow? Yeah, he accosted me a few days ago. We chatted for a while. Not by choice, of course. But because I didn't know how to get out of the conversation. A bit like now. It got a little out of hand. He insisted that I take a pamphlet. Let's have a look at this. Be Your Own God, an introductory guide to the cult of reason by Jacques Ebert. He even added his own signature, see? At the bottom there. To my new bestest bud, Eric. Happy reading. Best wishes, Slivius. Green ink too. What a fiendish colour choice. The pen's got green ink. That guy is such a slimeball. We aren't even close to bestest buddies. At least we now know the cultist's name. Silvius. Do you mind if we keep this pamphlet, monsieur? Be my guest. I don't want it. Okay. Do you want something else? He's asking about the uprising. Do you know anything about an uprising? An uprising? You know, people getting angry, being violent, overthrowing the government, stuff like that. Goodness, no, I don't know anything about that sort of thing. Never mind then. That's all. Thanks for your time, monsieur. You've been a great help. It's no trouble. No trouble at all. Let's have a look in the Salle de Tibre. Back in the old Salle de Tibre. I still don't see anybody around to interview. Yeah, I can't imagine this room being any use to us. Unless we need any priceless Roman artifacts, of course. Okay. Yep, let's go. Good call. We can always come back later if we've forgotten something. Okay, Tuesday. We're going to go to the Palais of Justice, see if we can talk to the judge about Robinho. Judge Maxime. Oh, hello, Monsieur Falcon and Blue Burton? Sparrowson. Right, Sparrowton. Your Honour, We heard that you had an accident with a flight of stairs. It's good to see you back on your feet.
A flight of stairs? No, no. I was actually assaulted, if you can believe that.
I can believe that.
I was just standing by the Seine, minding my own business, and the next thing I know, I was on a riverbank 100 kilometres downstream.
That sounds a little familiar.
When I awoke, I had a mild case of amnesia. I thought I was an exalt accountant. It took 2 weeks for me to return to full mental health.
In any case, Your Honour, it's good to see you back and healthy.
Would you mind if we ran a couple of questions by as part of an investigation we're undertaking?
By all means, ask away, Monsieur.
Judge Maxime, have you ever heard of a person called the Croque-Monsieur?
You're referring to the arms dealer, aren't you?
Yes, have you ever convicted him?
No. The man is notoriously unfindable and uncatchable.
I don't think anyone working in law enforcement has so much as seen his face.
That's crazy.
Well, there's no reason why we can't be the first to stop him. Right, Falcon?
Judge Maxine, have you heard any rumours about an uprising?
Of course, tons. You have no idea how many criminals rant about bringing down the government. You know, I was the one in charge of prosecuting the ones behind the June Days uprising of 32. That was some messy legal work.
What about recently? Have you heard anyone talk of anything specific?
Well, I'm not attached to the case, but I hear that imposter Judge Romulus had some very strange things to say. Cult, anarchy, fire and gunpowder. The man is not mentally stable.
We knew that much already. That's all.
Thank you for your time, Your Honour.
Any time, Messieurs.
So Wednesday, we're getting closer to Friday.
I think what I'm going to do is finish the episode up there. So thank you guys for watching so much. I really enjoy playing through Avairy Attorney.
I'll catch you guys next time.